right. Well, we have 2 weeks left in our doctrinal statement, so we are really at the end. And today, under our subject of last things, we're going to talk about a subject that I think is very difficult to talk about. I want to begin by going back to last Monday morning when my alarm went off. It would have been, as I meet with the elders, we meet together early that 4:45 the alarm went off Monday morning, and I managed to put my feet on the floor, and I picked up my smartphone. I've gotten into the habit of opening it up and looking at the news, sort of first thing, as something happened overnight that would be of interest to me. And so I'm looking at the headline news, and I saw that Kim Kardashian was on a jet fleeing home from Paris, France, where she had been robbed in her motel room at gunpoint by 5 men, and they had stolen $10 million in jewels from her. I had no idea at that moment that Kim Kardashian would make the sermon, but it's happened. So the news report stated that 5 armed masked men who were still at large stole a box containing valuables worth $6.7 million, as well as a ring worth $4 million. Police said that the robbers tied up Kardashian, locked her in her bathroom before escaping on bikes. They apparently were dressed up as policemen. Well, I went to the restaurant, met with the guys, and came to church, started working, thinking about what I'd share this morning, as I tend to do that on Monday. I focus on that, and usually I have a pretty good idea. This Monday I didn't. I really had just had been busy and hadn't had a chance to even look at what the next thing in the doctrinal statement was. Well, as I'm thinking about the subject, and this story came back to my mind, and I asked the question, if Kim Kardashian had been killed in that robbery, where would she have gone? And I did something that I've never done before for Kardashian. I prayed for her. And my prayer was that that experience of being held at gunpoint, which, you know, wouldn't that be utterly terrifying? That would cause her to think about her future destiny. Our Thursday shepherding group is reading a book by John Piper, and it's called Money, Sex, and Power. And I just use those categories, and I filtered Kardashian's life through those categories: money, sex, and power. Now, I don't know how many followers she has on Facebook. I assume a lot. I can say this, in those three categories, she's influential in each of those. But not in a God-honoring way. But praying that this experience would cause her to think about her own mortality, and perhaps God would meet her in that. And wouldn't it be extraordinary if she came to Christ? Certainly, shouldn't we pray for people in that vein? You know, I know you're all following the presidential campaign process, and it's so disappointing, isn't it? It just seems like it can't get any worse, really. It's such a dilemma to even know what to do. The news of this week involving Donald Trump, and I think all you can do is pray for them. Shouldn't we pray for Hillary Clinton? Shouldn't we pray for Donald Trump? One of them's going to be elected, it would seem, and the only hope is that person would become converted through the gospel and the person's worldview would really change. So if Kim Kardashian became a Christian, how could she use money, sex, and power in a way that would be God-honoring? According to statistics, and I realize statistics are dangerous things, you can prove almost anything with statistics, but from what I've read, 80% of people in the United States believe in the existence of heaven. Also, according to statistics, only 6% of Americans, so people in Stanfield, if we were to go door to door, people who you rub shoulders with, only 6% of Americans believe that they will go to hell. So the vast majority of people, average people in our community, believe, the words are the follow, they believe that their chance of going to heaven is good to excellent. Only 6% believe that they could go to punishment. I suppose that's not new. Jonathan Edwards, writing some 250 years ago, makes this statement of his own generation. He says, almost every natural man that hears of hell flatters himself that he shall escape it. He depends upon himself for his own security. He flatters himself in what he has done, in what he is now doing, or what he intends to do. Everyone lays out matters in his own mind, how he shall avoid damnation, and flatters himself that he contrives well for himself and that his schemes will not fail. Well, our understanding of hell has to be based on something more substantial than public opinion. The only way that we can get answers on a subject like this from a Christian perspective is to go to the Bible, to ask the question, what does the Bible teach us on this difficult subject? And so that's what we want to do today. That's where our doctrinal statement has led us this morning. And I want to begin by reminding you that in the New Testament, there are three words that are used for hell. In other words, when you encounter the word hell in your Bible, in the New Testament, behind that word is a Greek word, and there's a possibility of one of three different words. Now, I'm going to skip over two of those words, and I'm going to draw attention to the most stark, the most dark of these words that are used to designate hell, and that is the word Gehenna. Now, this word is used 12 times in the New Testament. And if you pay attention, you've heard me make this statement in the past, but I'm going to make it again. It is so significant. Of those 12 uses of the word Gehenna, listen to this, 11 of those occurrences come from the lips of Jesus. That, it seems to me, is really significant. In fact, when I first discovered this many years ago, well, you know, it made an impression upon me because I made that statement from time to time over the years. I was struck by that realization. This is the hardest word for hell in the Bible, used 12 times in the New Testament, and 11 of those occurrences are on the lips of Jesus. What does that mean? Well, it means that Jesus is the major teacher on hell in the New Testament. And so that causes us to ask another question, doesn't it? At least in my mind, the question is, well, why is that the case? Particularly because we think of Jesus as being the gentle Jesus, don't we? We're right to think of Jesus as being the one who offers hope, who offers redemption. Jesus is the one who we find him in the home of the tax collectors and the publicans and the prostitutes. And so it comes as a surprise to us to realize that Jesus actually has more to say about hell than he does about heaven. And I'll suggest to you two reasons why I think this is perhaps the case. The one is that it seems to me with what the New Testament has to say about hell, there is wisdom in having Jesus be the major teacher on that subject. It's almost as if, I hope you understand what I'm saying here, I am not for a moment wanting to suggest that in your Bible, if you have a red letter edition, maybe you do, don't you? I have a red letter edition. I don't really like red letter editions. It's just, this is what I found. But the red letter edition, the danger is that you would think that if it's in red, it's more important than the rest of the book. That's not true. We accept the Bible as the inspired word of God. If you know what I'm talking about, a red letter edition is certain Bibles, it'll take the teaching of Jesus and put that teaching in red, the rest is in black. Don't hear me saying that the red is more important than the black. But nevertheless, it does seem to me, perhaps this is a helpful statement if you understand it right, it's almost as if no mere apostle can teach on hell. It has to come from the lips of Jesus. It has to have that level of authority for us to fully accept it. The other thought that comes to me, and this actually is a comforting thought, is to realize if hell is real, and if what the Bible says about hell does represent reality, then we should recognize that by Jesus touching on this subject as often as he does, it really is an expression of his love. It's an expression of his compassion. He cares too much about people to simply be silent on this subject. So if we are Christians, and I know most of you in this room would claim to be Christians, and I would hope all of you in time would become Christians, then our very title means that we are the followers of Christ. We follow Jesus the Christ. And so our concern when it comes to this subject, any subject in reality, but particularly this subject this morning, our concern is not what the opinion polls suggest. We don't formulate our doctrines by going door to door or counting noses. We form our doctrine by going to Scripture and asking the question, what does Scripture actually teach us? And so on this subject, we have much to say, and much of it does come from the lips of Jesus himself. Let me just give you one example of this. In Luke chapter 12, so if you take your Bibles with me and turn to Luke chapter 12. Page 871, if you are using the Pew Bible or the Chair Bible. Pew Bible just sounds better, doesn't it? Page 871. Luke chapter 12, beginning in verse 4. Jesus is preaching. From verse 1, we realize he's preaching to a very large group. It says there were thousands of people gathered together. They were actually trampling one another to hear him preach. It reminds you of the Great Awakening of the 18th century, where buildings would be filled up, buildings much bigger than this one. And outside the building, there would be great crowds. The windows would be open. People would be sitting in the windowsills to hear the preaching of the Word of God, of people like Whitfield and Wesley. Jesus is preaching to thousands of people, and this is what he says beginning in verse 4. I tell you, my friends, Now, when you read the word, my friends, I think you should take comfort in that word. Should you not? Do you not take comfort in that word? It is so easy for us to just pass over little words to get to the main thought, but we shouldn't pass over that word. I tell you, my friends. So Jesus is addressing people, and he's doing so with love and with compassion. He says, do not fear those who kill the body. I mean, he can give many examples of who that would be. The Romans, for instance. The authorities. The occupying power. He says, do not fear those who can kill the body, but after that, there's nothing more that they can do. But I will warn you whom to fear. Fear him after he is killed, has authority to cast into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. By the way, I'm just going to leave my sermon notes for a moment to go back to my office. I'm not leaving. That's not what I mean. I was teaching Sunday school this morning, so my mind is going to my study, but my body's staying here. Veronica asked me, Veronica, where are you today? There she is. She asked me, because we're going through a membership class, and she asked, we read something in our doctrine statement, I think that's where it was, and she said, Pastor John, what does it mean to fear the Lord? That's a good question, isn't it? I've been asked that question much over the years. And that's not the exact expression here, but the text does say, Jesus is saying, we understand this in context, to fear God. Fear him whom after he is killed has authority to cast into hell. The wisdom literature of the Old Testament says the beginning of wisdom, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So, what does the Bible mean when it makes statements like that? And I shared with her something I've shared with some of you in the past, and perhaps you've heard this before, but I think it's relevant to share it again right now. I shared how years ago I was listening to a sermon, and the preacher, he said, imagine being on a plane in an Arctic region. And so every place you look, it's covered by ice and snow, and it's this large plain. And you turn behind you, maybe you hear something in the distance, and you turn around, and what you see approaching is a storm. This is the equivalent to the hurricane that hit Florida, but it's the Arctic equivalent. Sustained gusts of 140 miles per hour. And you are experienced. You understand the Arctic. You experience storms. And you know that if that storm reaches you, it'll kill you. It'll kill you in a hurry. And so what do? Well, you turn around and you start scanning the horizon. I need shelter and I need it soon. I'm at 140 miles an hour. If a storm's moving that fast, it's going to get to you soon, isn't it? And you see a cave, maybe it's a mile, maybe it's two, and you begin to run to that cave, and you arrive just in time, and you literally hide yourself in that cave. It is your protection. Now I want you to think of that cave as being like the righteousness of Christ. You are hidden in it, you are protected by it. You are accepted, significant, and secure in the sight of God because you are secure in the cave of the righteousness of Christ. Now, going back to our illustration, if you are secure in that place, is it not true that you could buck up your strength, your courage, and walk to the entrance of that cave in this place of safety? Look at that raging storm, feel that raging storm, listen to that raging storm, and in that place of safety, you could say, is it not awesome? Indeed, it's glorious. It is powerful. It is overwhelmingly strong. we talk about the fear of the Lord, I think that's what the Bible is trying to produce within us. A reverence and a respect for the glorious holiness of God. And it's meant to lead us to a place where we would be deeply grieved by the very thought of doing anything that would bring dishonor to His great name. But from that place of safety and security, we actually worship this God who, apart from Christ, this God who would annihilate us, but this God who is giving and sending and sent Christ and gave Christ out of love so that we can be at peace with Him. Indeed, what a marvelous God He is. And so Jesus says here, I warn you to fear Him who after He is killed has authority to cast into hell. How many times have I said this over the years? Don't ask God for justice. He might give it to you. I think that's what Jesus is saying here. If God gives you justice, people wake up. You don't want His justice. You cannot endure His justice. And so rejoice that as far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. You see what I've just done? I'm preaching on hell, but I'm trying to preach on hell through the filter of the Christian gospel. Every subject must come back to the gospel. It's the gospel that gives us hope. It's the gospel that secures us even when we consider a subject such as this one. Jesus says here that God the Father has the authority to cast into hell. And then in verses 13 through 21, He gives that famous parable of the rich fool who builds bigger barns, who feels that his wealth secures him, not knowing that he will lose his very own life, that when he needs wealth the most, it will sprout wings and it will desert him and fly away and leave him before God, naked, ashamed, and hopeless. Jesus says, this one, the Father, has the authority to cast into hell. Now the word there is Gehenna. This is the word I mentioned to you earlier, the harsh word for hell. And so what does that word mean? Well, I want to talk about that for a few moments. The New Testament paints a very vivid picture, and it is coming out of an understanding that Jesus' original audience would have had no difficulty wrapping their minds around, because it was rooted in their history. It's rooted in the Old Testament. So you got to go way back into the Old Testament to the time of King Ahaz and King Manasseh. Remember King Manasseh? What's that? Evil. Extraordinarily evil. In fact, after his reign, it is as if, in the mind of God, grace is ran out. Judgment will come upon the nation because of the sin of Manasseh. Now, what was Manasseh's worst sin? Any of you remember? Manasseh introduced to Judah, the southern kingdom, the worship of Moloch. And the worship of that pagan deity involved child sacrifice. This was done in a narrow, deep ravine outside the city of Jerusalem. That ravine is known to us as the Valley of Hinnom. When you take the Valley of Hinnom and transliterate it and translate it from Aramaic, There's a process that you go through. The Valley of Hinnom is Gehenna of the teaching of Jesus. It is the very same location. So what is in view in Jesus' mind is this narrow ravine outside the city of Jerusalem where child sacrifices had been offered. Eventually, King Josiah takes the throne and he brings an end to that practice. He brings revival to the land. But he realized that there was evil associated with that location, so it is his desire to desecrate the site. And he did that by turning it into the city dump of the city of Jerusalem. And so in the first century, this location was filled with garbage. And therefore, there was always flame in this garbage dump. Because there's more garbage coming each and every day, and the only way to get rid of it is to burn it. Also in the first century, this is the place where dead animals were put, and the Romans would put criminals, corpses, in this garbage dump. And that is the background to Mark 9, where Jesus, speaking again of Gehenna, he describes it this way. This is the place where the fire is never quenched and the worm never dies. The fire is never quenched because there's always more garbage to be burned. The worm doesn't die because the maggots always have a fresh corpse to work on. Now that's an awful imagery, isn't it? It is a place of ruination. It is a place of destruction. But that is the imagery that stands behind the word that Jesus uses time and time again in the New Testament to paint a picture for us to reveal something of what hell is like. Now, in our day, and I honestly don't know how common this teaching is, but I do want to address it at least for a moment. In our day, there is a teaching, and it's called annihilationism. You heard of it? Even if you've never heard of it, you might sort of detect the direction of it, even in the word annihilationism. So annihilationism is the belief that hell is a temporary place of punishment. It is a denial that hell is forever. And again, I do not know how many Christians believe this. I know there are particular denominations that teach it. And my suspicion, given how hard the teaching about hell is, my suspicion would be that many Christians would be tempted to believe in annihilationism. And so this is one of those issues, but I'm asked the question from time to time, what do you think of this? What do you make of this? And so I want to spend a little bit of time with it. And I want to ask you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 25. In Matthew chapter 25, page 831, beginning in verse 31, my Bible, probably yours does this as well, there's a title. Those titles are not part of the original text, they're not inspired, but they're often helpful. My title reads, The Final Judgment. And so the editors are saying it's their belief that what this parable concerns is the very end. The second coming and the final judgment. So let's read some of this. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, this is the divine Son of Man, this is Daniel 7. When he comes in his glory with all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. This is the world being made right, there is something really beautiful about this. And by the way, this is next Sunday. Next Sunday, I'm preaching on the second coming. What will that bring for us as God's people? Verse 32, before him will be gathered all the nations. So there's no exceptions here. No one can say, well, I've got a bad cold this morning and I'm just not going to show up. Or I'm on vacation. Maybe call me in 2 weeks. It's a sovereign authority that is irresistible. He gathers not some of the nations, he gathers all of the nations. And we read that he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. Of course, if you know the story, if you know the parable, you realize you want to be among the sheep. You also discover something here that initially seems surprising perhaps to us. The judgment is based upon works, isn't it? It's all about how you treated other individuals for the sake of Christ. It's not a denial at all that we are saved by grace alone. It is rather an affirmation that while we are saved by grace alone, the grace that saves us also changes us. It is a powerful work of God within a person's heart. So that where there is real life, if there is spiritual life, if there is eternal life, what is the property of life? One of the properties of life is fruit. Living things produce fruit. And so it's the fruit that is evaluated, and the fruit reveals whether or not the faith is living faith. We work our way through the rest of the chapter. Look at verses 45 and 46. Then he will answer them. The them here refers to the goats, those who are outside of Christ, those who do not believe the gospel, those who have rejected the Savior, those whose lives reveal that they're still dead in their sin. Truly I say to you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it unto me. And then verse 46, and these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Now, I really applaud the English Standard Version here, because they use the word eternal twice, right? Eternal punishment and eternal life. Some translations, for the ease of reading, we don't want to use the same word over and over and over again. We use a slightly different word with basically the same meaning. But the ESV, I think, is right to use the word eternal because in Greek, it is the very same word. The very same word is used twice. So, eternal punishment and eternal life, one Greek term in both of those instances. So this is why, for me, annihilationism is really hard to affirm. It's not clearly taught anywhere in the Bible. And a passage such as this one would really cast doubt upon that understanding. Do you understand why I say this? Because you ask the question, what do you think eternal life means? What does it mean to you? I've heard forever and forever. I think for all of us, eternal life basically means that we are conscious, that we are aware, that we are enjoying the presence of God forever and forever. Doesn't that seem right? In fact, let us understand here, I think this is probably important to emphasize, hell is a teaching in the Bible, but it is a minor theme overall. Redemption is the major theme. Judgment is the minor theme. And so given that redemption is the major theme, it is right for us to affirm there is no one in the entire universe who is more joyful than God. He is the joyful God. And that is so important for us to understand and believe, because our eternity is wrapped up in being made joyful in Him. If He's the gloomy God for all of eternity, oh, what a pathetic, sad thought. How can we ever be joyful if we exist forever in the presence of the gloomy God? No, He is the most joyful of all beings. So let us understand that. Our whole hope is being caught up into His conscious presence forever. Well, beloved, if that is eternal life, then I simply ask the question, what would eternal punishment mean? And what do you think that would look like? See, I've saved to this point to actually read our statement. I didn't want to start with it because it is so hard. It's in your sermon notes. Let me read it to you. We believe that all unsaved persons at the point of physical death are destined for eternal damnation. They will be resurrected, separated from the righteous. That's the text we just read. Judged and cast into an existence of eternal punishment, where they will be tormented day and night, forever and ever, when death and Hades is cast into the lake of fire. Wow. That is harsh. But I think that is the teaching of Scripture. And I think that is the teaching of the New Testament. We could go to Revelation 14 and Revelation 20. It's in my notes, but in the interest of time, I think we will not do that today. I do want to make this observation, though, and this has been helpful to me. I put it in the notes this way: hell is not a corrections facility. You understand what I mean by that? Hell is not a corrections facility. Now, I'm not part of corrections. There are some men in here who are. I'm surmising at this point, and I think I'm right. If I'm wrong, I know they'll tell me later. I have confidence of that. But, you know, it seems significant to me that we don't talk anymore about penitentiaries. When I hear the word penitentiary, I think of the word punishment, don't you? Penitentiary punishment. You know, we talk instead of corrections facilities. And that's rather significant. I think that's an intentional change. And I'm assuming, again, I'm not in corrections, but my assumption is that the thinking behind that is that when people go into one of those institutions or facilities, the goal of it is to correct them. Is that right, James? Am I okay? To correct them so that they can eventually re-enter society and hopefully be suitable for society. There is nothing like that taught in Scripture concerning hell. So again, I put it this way: hell is not a corrections facility. Let me read the words of William Shedd. The language is somewhat archaic, but I think he makes a point here that is really worth considering. He writes, one sin makes guilt, and guilt makes hell. But while this is so, it is a fact to be observed that sin is actually being added to in the future life. And the amount of sin is accumulating. The finally lost are not to be conceived of as having a faint desire and aspirations for a holy and heavenly state, and is feebly inclined to sorrow for their sin, but are kept in hell contrary to their yearning and petition. There is not a single throb of godly sorrow or a single pulsation of holy desire in the lost spirit. Sin ultimately assumes a fiendish form and degree. Does that make sense? I can translate his words this way. He's simply saying, there are not repentant people in hell. In hell, what you have are people who are given over to their sin. People who throughout eternity continue to be at odds with God. And therefore, in a certain sense, hell is simply the place where people go who want nothing to do with God. And so God is removed from them in the sense of ever doing them any good or ever bringing them up into his joy. So hell is a place of ruination. It is a place of separation from the good God. But it is a place where God is to be found as judge. What do we do with this teaching? I know, because I know you and I know me, we cannot help but think of this teaching in the context of our own relatives and loved ones. We cannot help but think of this teaching even in the context of people who've gone before us, people who we care greatly about. And there are people in my life who've been in that category. There are people in my life where I have to say, only God knows. Amen. It's not for me to decide. I cannot read any person's heart. I believe that God is good, and I believe that God is just, and only God knows. But as we close, I will make this observation. I do want to read one additional passage to you. But the observation is this: our thinking and preaching and praying about hell, we dare not divorce this topic from the gospel. Hell reminds us of a world that needs the gospel. I take you back to where I started this morning. You remember I said that according to statistics, only 6% of Americans believe that they are in danger of going to hell. Over 80% of Americans believe in heaven, and they believe their chance of going there is good to excellent. So in a town of the size of Stanfield with some roughly 2,000 people, I didn't do the math, but 6%, what would that be? 150? 125? It's a very small number, isn't it? So we are working with, rubbing shoulders with, having conversations with people who do not believe they are in any danger of going to hell. I think words that are appropriate as we close would be the words of the Apostle Paul when he writes in Romans chapter 9, verse 3. And these are words, honestly, I've read these words, I've marveled over these words. I don't even know what to do with these words. But he is thinking of his own people, the Jewish people, who in large numbers rejected Jesus as the Messiah. He says in Romans chapter 9, verse 3, "For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen, according to the flesh." And that says to me, my wife today asked me, she said, "What are you preaching on?" Because she was picking on music, and I said, "I'm preaching on hell." You know, good luck on music selection. I didn't say that, I didn't need to. And she looked at me and sort of smiled and said, "Hellfire and brimstone." And I said, "No." And that's all I said. That was the end of the conversation. No one should preach hellfire and brimstone. Yet if you preach this subject and you divorce it from the gospel, and you divorce it from a heart that desires people to come to Christ, then maybe you can preach hellfire and brimstone. But may that never be true of any of us. May we believe what the Bible teaches. May we use it to motivate us to proclaim the gospel. But may we truly do it with tears in our eyes. Let's pray. Father God, we do come to you today, and we realize you are glorious. You are like that storm, that if it comes upon us, and if we are not in a place of protection, that storm, indeed, it will rip us apart. It will kill us. We will be destroyed. We cannot endure the presence of such a storm. Lord, I hope that I pray for every person in this room at this moment. We are people who not only believe the gospel, we are people who rejoice in the gospel. We rejoice that there is a place of protection provided for us. The walls of that cave are very thick and very strong. The righteousness of Christ satisfies the holiness, your holiness, so that we can look upon you and marvel over your glorious beauty. And we can reverence you, but we need not fear you in the sense of being condemned to hell. But Lord, in praying that, we recognize that we live in a culture that has turned its back on you. A culture that does not believe the Bible. A culture, undoubtedly, the majority report of this sermon preached today would be how awful and how primitive and how barbaric and how unworthy. Because we believe we live in a culture that if there's any belief in God at all, it is only a God of love. It is a God stripped of glory, justice, and holiness. Oh Lord, we pray for our culture. We pray for our loved ones. We pray for our children. We pray, Lord, that the gospel would get deep into all of us. And in praying this way, we also want to avoid the air. Oh, and it can be a great air. It can do us so much spiritual harm. Of thinking that Jesus is gracious and you are only severe. And so we remind ourselves of Scripture. 1 John 4:10. This is love. Not that we loved you, but that you loved us and sent your Son into this world. So we encourage ourselves with the thought, the teaching of Scripture, that you, the Father, you are the giving and the sending God. And you do it out of love in order to redeem. Father God, may you take this teaching and use it in our hearts for our good and for your glory. We commit this to you and we pray in Jesus' name.